5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Scripture is clear. Women cannot be pastors. They cannot be in authoritative position over men in the church. You cannot be a practicing homosexual and call yourself a Christian.
People like you cause people to run away from the church screaming.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it. I award you no points, and may God have mercy on your soul.
You can be mad at me all you want, but you better get in line. There's a long waiting list ahead of you.
I want the truth! You can't handle the truth!
All right, welcome to another episode of Crossroads Radio. Well, it is Wednesday, January 18th, 2017. Thank you for tuning in. Sorry about the technical difficulty in the beginning there. If you guys are listening live here on Spreaker, and it's speaker with an R, Spreaker. And we basically, I forgot to flip a switch. That's what it came down to, is I forgot to flip a switch. Yeah, be careful how I say that. I don't know. I had some switch flipping to do, and I forgot to go ahead and flip and connect a switch that needed to be connected. So I do apologize for if you guys are listening and you had no audio for the first few seconds there. Now, welcome to Crossroads Radio. Like I said, we kind of changed up the intro a little bit. So, got a new intro going today. Worked on that over the week. Worked on that earlier today. Doing intros and extras and all that kind of stuff takes minutes to do. So, I just find the music and then I go ahead and put them together real quick. I got a nice little application for doing that on the computer. So, I hope you guys are all doing well. What is this show about? The Crossroads Radio is a weekly show, and we're most probably going to be going bi-weekly here soon. And we talk about all sorts of different things, from politics, religion, to anything and everything that is affecting our walk with Christ. So, we also do this on Facebook Live, and if you guys are on Facebook Live, hello, welcome. You guys can go ahead and join in there and ask questions, make comments, and I will answer them live on the air as we go. Now, today, what do we have in store? Well, as you know, Friday is going to be the inauguration of President-elect Trump. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that to begin with. not so much. I want to stay away from the political aspects, and really I don't care, you know, really if someone is Republican, Democrat, or what, or if they're not favoring Trump, or if they're for Trump, or whatever. Isn't the point of really talking about what I'm going to talk about dealing with this. Really don't have any emails to talk about today, so we're going to kind of just run the gamut and talk about a couple other things. I want to talk a little bit later in the show after our first break about Clayton Jennings and his attempt to come back and hit the circuit again after his exposure of the sin he was involved in. I want to talk briefly about that after in the second part of the show. So we're going to be discussing that. Now, like I said, the inauguration is happening Friday. And if you know, you may be for Trump, you may be against Trump, and it really isn't a point. The point I want to bring up is that as Christians, if you're listening to this, an article came out here just the other day, actually today, on WND.com, and I believe that's WorldNewsDaily.com, and it basically talks about Trump and Bishop Wayne T. Jackson of Great Faith Ministries International in Detroit, Michigan, is going to be going out and basically praying and speaking at the inauguration and praying with Trump, basically as a lead ceremony kind of pastor at this at the ceremonies. And I wanted to mainly talk about today in this first part here is basically the issue that I have personally. I think a lot of discerning Christians should have, and we really need to have, is Bible-believing, discerning Christians who practice the art of apologetics, defending the faith, as we are contending for biblical faith, and as we are polemicists, pointing out truth from error. We need to be looking at everybody and everything through the lens of Scripture, and kind of doing our own investigating of who and what and, you know, what is going on, especially who Trump is putting around himself as spiritual advisors. Now, we've warned about, and I've talked about this on this show, on Crossroads Radio, several times in the past about, you know, Paula White, and they've written over at Pulpit and Pen. I've written a couple articles on it. Other guys have written over there. Jeff Maples, Bud Adren has written on it. Seth Dunn has written on just basically who, or, you know, Paula White and her being a false teacher. We talked about, you know, her being a false teacher and Trump surrounding himself with false teachers last week. And I kind of want to touch on this because when this article came out, I was looking through my news feed, and, you know, I was kind of just doing some investigating, as Christians we should be doing, is investigating. And, you know, it sounds good, like this this Bishop T. Jackson of Great Faith Ministries International in Detroit. You know, it sounded great. You know, he talks a really good piece here in this article. He's saying that, you know, the reason he was in this article was because he's basically getting hate mail and threats because he's speaking at Trump's inauguration. And what's going on here is he's, you know, being told he's being sold out, and, you know, sold out the black community and all this other stuff, it says in the article here. And, you know, he's going against, you know, his community and that. And he's basically saying that Jesus, you know, he's going there to preach the gospel. And that's fine and great. And, I'm not putting him down for that if he's preaching the biblical gospel. And it sounded great in the article. Wonderful in the article. I mean, I was like, oh, hey, that's good that, you know. Well, as anything, I just don't stop at when I see, you know, it's sounding good, and we shouldn't, as Christians, read an article and stop. And that's for any article. That's any article you read, you know, regardless of my website, any website, you know, over at Empowered by Christ, Crossroads Radio, any of those sites. You just don't stop and go, oh, hey, you know, that sounds good. You go and investigate and check it out. And not only that, you take it back to Scripture, and you be a Berean, and you search all things. I've often said this, you know, just because I say it, or, you know, it's written somewhere, don't believe it. Go investigate it. Check it out. Check the facts. And do some of that old-fashioned investigating. You know, a lot of times, you know, it's an art that has been forgotten over the years. You know, back when people used to, journalists, reporters, whatever you want to say, you know, even radio show, talk show hosts at the time, would actually go out and pound the pavement and investigate things. Well, while investigating, I basically Googled and checked out Mr. Bishop Wang T. Jackson's church, which is the Great Faith Ministries International in Detroit. And coming across the website and checking their church out, I went and, as soon as I can find my mouse here, I'm a little stalling because I got three screens here set up, and for some reason I lost my pointer. There it is. All right. Now, as I was saying, now his church in Minnesota Michigan basically is, I'm going to say, it's a charismatic apostolic church. So right there was a warning flag right off the bat. When I heard this and I started checking out the site, One of the things in the Balt, or, the Balt section is they believe in miraculous healings and such not, and all that charismatic, strange fire type of stuff. I'm going to put out there all the shenanigans about, the modern day Montanism, they're saying, you can be expected to be healed of all sorts of ailments, ranging from cancer, diabetes, as well as various physical and emotional illnesses. Well, check out the vagueness on this. Various physical and emotional illnesses. So what does that mean? Does that mean I go to Mr. Bishop Wayne T. Jackson's Church of Great Detroit, Michigan, the Great Faith Ministries International Church? And my back hurts, and I have them lay my hand or their hands on me, and all of a sudden, hey, my back stops hurting. Oh, wow, look at that miraculous healing, that miracle. No, that's not, I would love to speak from the person that, the claim here are, ranging from ailments ranging from cancer. I'd love to speak to the doctor. I'd love to speak to that person who was... had cancer, and that person was healed from that from cancer. I'd love to. Maybe, if this church is so, not to poke fun here, and I'm not mocking, not trying to mock, I'm not going to use the mocking voice, but maybe Nabil Qureshi should go there and leave Bethel Church and go there and maybe get his hands laid on and get cured of cancer. I mean, they're claiming in their statement here, in their about section, that they can cure cancer. Maybe he should go there. I mean, I don't know. I'm not saying that to be, disingenuous as it sounds, but I mean, they're making these statements, so it must have happened, right? Now, here's the thing. Exactly when we're looking at this article and we're looking, hey, this sounds great, this pastor's going to pray at this thing. Well, it's kind of important to surround and look at the people that Trump is surrounding himself as spiritual advisors. I'm going to get to that in a second, because it's kind of alarming. It really is alarming. Because we've already kind of said, and talked about Paula White on previous shows, and, there's plenty of articles, and we've kind of pointed and showed that, that she's a pastor, she doesn't belong in the authoritative position she is, according to the Bible. And... we're looking at that, and when we see that, we have to go and look at other red flags of who Trump is surrounding himself with, and we're going to look at that real shortly. And I want to bring up real quickly here something else. As I was reading this, I'm looking over here at the statement of faith at this church, this Great Faith International Ministries. There is a severe problem here, and this is something that should be another red flag. It says, God uses Bishop Jackson, that would be Wayne T. Jackson, and Dr. Beverly. And so I did a little bit of investigating, because sometimes, you're like, could it be a woman pastor? Could it not be a woman pastor? Maybe she's just, over prayer, praise over people, possibility. But the way it's worded here, it kind of threw up that red flag. It's like, and so... she is a pastrix. So this church has a pastrix, a woman in authority over men and violating scripture. So right there should be a major concern. So now you have, looking at this here, you have basically at Trump's inaugurational speech, and this shouldn't be surprising. I mean, if you look at the condition of modern day American Christianity and the downgrade that is the American church. I mean, if you want to just sum up the definition of downgrade, just write American evangelicalism after it, and that'll be the full definition of downgrade in the context of a church. Now, we should be concerned, and greatly concerned, I believe, with what we see here with Trump. I mean, not only is he has this person who's, praying over, with them, he's also having Pastor Paula, or Pastrix Paula White of New Destiny Church center or Christian center in Florida. At least, I will say this, at least these false teachers aren't calling them churches. So, I mean, that's kind of a good thing, I guess. I mean, if you want to look for a bright side of things, that's better. I mean, you know, they're not calling themselves a church. So, that's a good thing. Now, as far as who else is going to be praying at this and speaking, and there's also going to be, as according to this article here at WND, also taking part in Trump's swearing in Friday will be Reverend Franklin Graham. Questionable, very questionable. Reverend Billy Graham and Cardinal Timothy Dolan, the Catholic Archbishop of New York, Rabbi Marvin Hearn, Dean and founder of the Simon Westerial Center, and Paula White, along with Samuel Rodriguez, president of the National Hispanic Christian Leader Conference. Well, here's the thing. He surrounded himself pretty well with... okay, Joe, a comment in here on on Facebook Live. If you guys are in there, Joe typed in and chimed in here and said he wants to change his gender so he can be a pastrix. I'm sure that could be done for you, Joe. I'm sure that could be done. Archbishop Dolan, Hail Mary. Yeah. Yeah, Joe's poking fun at the Roman Catholics, and rightly so. He's got an interesting... He grew up Roman Catholic, so he knows everything they teach. and all the false teachings they teach. Now, as I was saying, Trump has basically surrounded himself really well, if you want to say, with a bunch of false teachers and heretics. I mean, you have... And a bunch of NAR, New Apostolic Reformation type individuals who basically, I want to say... whether or not, you know, if you want to agree with me, that's fine. If you disagree, whatever, you know, you're allowed to be wrong. That's fine. And, you know, he surrounded himself with a whole bunch of heretics. I mean, you have Samuel Rodriguez. He's a NAR, New Apostolic type. And if you're not familiar when I say NAR, I'm talking about the New Apostolic Reformation, which is a subordinate or sub-Christian heretical movement within the Protestant church or Protestant Christianity. And I would say the NAR is not, or New Apostolic Reformation is not, a denomination. So if you're going to be going, looking around and going, oh, I want to stay away from that denomination because of what they believe and teach, well, you're not going to find it. It's a rather a loose network of denominational and independent churches that rally around a particular set of biblical interpretations. And I say interpretations because they're not biblical teachings. That's how they interpret the Bible. And they are interpreting it wrongly because they're not following Scripture. The New Apostolic Reformation approaches church leadership, biblical interpretation, spiritual warfare, and the power of religious leaders different significantly from mainstream Orthodox Presbyterian denominations. And I'm going to say this. Here's the main thing. The New Apostolic Reformation. Basically, I'm going to give it just a short encapsulation here of the history of the NAR. Because it's kind of really important here to understand. See what Trump, or who Trump is surrounding himself with. So you can get a view of what are, as biblical Christians, what our freedom, our religious freedom around Trump is going to look like for the next 4 years. I mean, you know, he has some say in that. He has some determination in that. It's not like, you know, but here's the thing. He's surrounding himself with false teachers. He's surrounding himself with people that, you know, do not represent biblical Christianity. He himself, I do not believe, is a Christian. He's a false Christian. He's a nominal Christian in name only. If you remember correctly, Paula White supposedly led him to Christ. And I use the air quotes around that. And also, you know, I'm going to say this too while I'm here. James Dobson, founder of Focus and Family, was there and, you know, supposedly, you know, heard this and witnessed this and testified to that. Well, it says something a little bit about James Dobson and Focus on the Family and that whole deal when you have, you know, associations with a pastrix or a false teacher. Basically a prosperity teacher and a woman pastor. And why you're associating with that and teaming up with those types, I don't know. It seems to me, and I've said this for some time, Focus on Family, James Dobson, the whole thing, it's gone off the rails for a long time, and basically they've kind of lost their relevance to any type of biblical Christianity. They're off in way in the left field. Now, like I was saying, now the New Apostolic Reformation traces its historical roots to the late 20th century and American charismatic churches. Came out of the Azusa Street Revival, started out of there, went with the Kansas City Prophets, a Toronto Blessing, and you may recognize this name. C. Peter Wagner was kind of the grandfather of this movement. The New Apostolic Reformation started to gain its power and influence, like I said, through the Toronto Blessing, and now has basically splintered off into various other groups, such as Hillsong, Bethel Church, Reading, IHOP, various other groups. Those are the key main ones, but there's other subordinate groups within there that teach these kind of, erroneous teachings, continuance of the apostolic gifts, that you can be an apostle, that you can raise the dead, and no, I'm not kidding. They actually, Bethel Church has courses in necromancy, which is the raising of the dead, and they supposedly, you know, have raised people from the dead. And if that's the case, if people like Bethel Church and that, and those in the NAR, New Apostolic Reformation, have done this, why are they not going around to church, hospitals and putting themselves in hospitals, and when somebody has a, you know, when somebody dies, why don't they raise them? You know, it's, to me, it's selfish. It's mean that they're not doing that. I mean, if they have this wonderful gift, why are they sinning and not doing that kind of stuff? But I'm saying that tongue in cheek, because of course we know from biblical Christianity there is only one. We are all appointed to die and to face judgment once, and we're not going to be risen again here on earth and by some, you know, NAR, New Apostolic Reformation witch chant and hocus pocus kind of garbage that's put out there. here's the thing. The NAR, New Apostolic Reformation, it's not anything really new. It's renamed, but it's been around. It's the same old heresy. There's no new heresies under the sun. It's just with a different twist. It's, you know, basically modernism. It comes out of the second century, and it's just modern day modernism, and the teaching that basically, you know, these gifts continue, these apostolic gifts continue, and some of these teachers include Lou Engle, the founder of the Call. I'm just going to rattle off a whole bunch of them here so you guys kind of get an idea. Get an idea, basically, of who is involved and how extensive. And some of these are big-name people that you most probably have listened to on podcasts. Maybe you've listened to on TV. To begin with, okay, here we got Lou Engle, founder of The Call, Mike and Cindy Jacobs, founder of Generals International, Bill Johnson, head pastor of Bethel Church, Rick Jointer, founder of Morningstar Ministries, John P. Kelly, founder of John P. Kelly Ministries, and, of course, Apostle C.P. Wagner, founder of Global Harvest Ministries. Mike Bickle, founder of the International House of Prayer, IHOP. And these are just some of the leaders or big names in there, in this movement. And this is the type of people that Trump is surrounding himself with and hooking up with. Included in there would be Samuel Rodriguez. He's a big NAR, New Apostolic Reformation type. And the problem is, as Christians, we need to be aware of who Trump is surrounding himself with, because what we're going to be looking at Friday, and maybe I'm wrong, I hope I'm wrong, maybe, Joel writes here, pancakes, yes, the International House of Pancakes, yeah, no, not the International House of Pancakes, so the International House of Prayer, or we could have, Trump's not a theologian, he doesn't know anything better. You're right, and here's the thing. I think that's on the fault, and Joel brings up a good point. I would say this. He doesn't know anything better. He's aligning himself with false teachers that appear to be, you know, biblical or represent Christianity or biblical Christianity. And I have to say, those who represent biblical Christianity, those who are solid-believing Christians, it's kind of our own fault. We kind of dropped the ball on it, if you want to say. We're allowing Trump, in many ways, to be surrounded by this garbage. I mean, it's kind of right now, it's kind of late to do anything about it at this point. We can pray. We can, you know, pray, try to intercede in that way, and pray that he comes to biblical Christians, and, you know, comes to a biblical saving faith. But right now, and Joe brings up a very good point, he thinks that the intentions is just to align himself with, quote, Christians. That's a good point. And that's exactly what Trump is doing in many ways. And regardless of his intentions, our intentions as Bible-believing Christians, we should be praying for Trump. We should be praying for this nation. We should be praying that Trump finds Christ, that Trump accepts biblical Christianity, that becomes a actual born-again believer, and he gets away from these false teachers. And you're right. And I would say, Joe, I would add this real quick here to your comment that, you know, he's aligning himself with Christians. The reason he is aligning himself with this type of Christianity, this version, this fake version of Christianity, is that it's so prevalent in America. It's mainstream, it's out there, it's, as he would put it, it's huge. And it's gonna be huge, you know, or I get used a one word additive verbs, I guess that's what he does. So he is aligning himself with that type of Christianity because that is what is getting him the attention and the namesake. So you're right, he doesn't know better. But it's just something as Christians we need to not fall for and go, oh look, he is for the Christians. No, he's for his agenda. He's for securing popular, you know, views or popularity. That's who he is for, and that's what he wants to be for. Well, after the break here, we're going to talk a little bit about Clayton Jennings and what is going on with him.
Ding dong! Jehovah's Witnesses. Ding dong! Mormons. Christian, are you ready to defend the faith when false religions ring your doorbell? Do you know what your Muslim and Jewish friends believe? You will if you get Andrew Rappaport's book, What Do They Believe? When we witness to people, we need to present the truth, but it is very wise to know what they believe, and you will get Andrew Rappaport's book at whatdotheybelieve.com.
Praise the Lord and pass the ammunition and we'll all stay free. Praise the Lord.
All right, well, welcome back. Short little break there. And like I said before that, I want to talk a little bit about Clayton Jennings. And if you guys are not familiar who Clayton Jennings is, well, he is a self-described evangelical, or he's a self-described evangelist and poet, author, poet, and basically he's going around, and maybe you guys see, he kind of looks like he's like the supermodel of Christianity, if you want, you know, he kind of is like the Clark Kent looking type person of Christianity, if you want to say, you know, the super, you know, supermodel type, I don't know, you know, or Fabio or whatever, I don't know, of Christianity. And he's basically going around, we've written a lot, and Jordan Hall's talked a lot about what he's been accused of and what has transpired in his ministry over, I'd say, some time here, about, it's come to light in the last 4 to 6 months, which includes, you know, seduction of women, in before he was married, seduction of women, fornication, lying, the use of alcohol for seduction, and also the use of the pill after that seduction, and basically, you know, lying and saying that he's going to make these women his wife and all this, and then basically dumping them, and at that point letting them, you know, ignoring them, basically giving them the cold shoulder and ignoring them after that. Well, we have exposed that and have done that over at Pulpit and Pen and over at Polemics Report. J.D. Hall did several articles on that, several podcasts on that, and exposed what he was up to. And I mean, and he has confessed to this. He's, you know, said outright, yeah, okay, well, certain parts of it's true, and he's, you know, said certain things, and, you know, he went away for a while, basically, you know, and his mentor, person he was working at the church over at Harbor Shores Church, Tony Nolan, he basically was mentoring him, going through it, you know, told him to take the website down and all this. Well, Clayton Jennings kind of said, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to do this other thing. He kind of left the church and left the mentorship of Tony Nolan and basically said, hey, I'm going to do my own thing. I'm not going to repent of this stuff because I already repented before Christ, and that was it. And I don't need any counseling or anything else, da-da-da-da-da. And basically he has, or is trying to stage a comeback. I mean, and the church he was at revoked his minister license, but, you know, that didn't stop him. So he's back on his own. You know, he went with a secular firm and left and said basically he's going to continue doing what he's going to do and he doesn't have to answer to anyone. That's basically the attitude and what is being put forth by him on that side of the aisle. So he has come forth and basically has decided that he's going to continue on, and there's these places that are continuing to, if you want to say, promote his stuff. And it kind of speaks, you know, kind of on the same line of false Christianity. At this point, all that has been exposed about Jennings and what he's done and who he is, if you're a church that continues to allow him to come and speak at your church to young women, to seduce them, to come in and promote his version of Christianity, with the past he's had and the, you know, just his outright unwillingness to step down, repent, and he is basically disqualified from the ministry. He cannot be doing what he's doing. It's not to say that he can't do things in ministry, but he can't do what he's doing in ministry because of the sins that he is involved or has been involved with. And I'll say this right now. The allegations from these women, and there's a bunch of them, it's just not one lady that came forward. There is several of them. I'm not going to tell exactly how many there are. Basically, if there's one, you go, okay, well, maybe it's a vengeful thing or, you know, whatever, you investigate. And then when numbers and numbers and numbers start coming forward of women that have been seduced or tricked or, you know, conned by this con artist, and I guess that's what he is. He's a con artist. And you start to question, you know, okay, what's going on here? And now, any church, like I said, any church that at this point, with all the information that's been put out there, you know, he had his mentor, Tony Nolan, he ended his their relationship. Basically, he washed his hands of him because he realized, hey, this guy's not any good. He's not willing to repent. He's not willing to go through a process of restoration. He's not willing to do any of that. He wants to continue doing what he wants to do. And I'll say this, I don't know of, you know, Clayton Jennings married his wife, and right now it's classic rebuild, the marketing 101 of rebuild your image. Prior to all this coming out, Jennings basically never had his wife involved in any of the ministry stuff, the photo shoots, any of the things. Now, since this, his wife is constantly in every single picture, every promo, every video he's put out, and it's a total marketing scheme of rebuild the image, look, I'm Mr. Family Guy, you know, kind of thing. And to deflect, basically to deflect the allegations against him. So at this point, any church that is out there that he is going to basically be speaking at, you really have to question, is it a biblical church? With the information out there. And it is possible. I mean, there's enough, you know, small churches out there, and I think that's where his venue is going to be stuck now for a while, for some time. There is enough churches out there that you kind of sometimes have to go, okay, it's small enough church, might not know about it. So over at Pulp and Pen, Seth Dunn, he wrote an article, put out there, just kind of highlighting and detailing, hey, this stuff is going on, it's continuing to go on, and this is where he's going to be. I mean, basically, in a nutshell, Clayton Jennings done us a favor, and those in the discernment world and those who want to warn people about what's going on and people to watch out for, he's posted his listing out there of where I'm going to be. I'm a false teacher. I'm going to be here, here, and here. Basically, I mean, that's what he's done. And Jennings basically, you know, on his website has posted, said, hey, here's my tour dates. Put them back up there. I'm going to be here and here. So what I'm doing is I'm encouraging you guys to go over to Pulpit and Pen and check out the article. And I posted it on my Facebook page over at Richard Haas. You can post it there. I also posted the article at Crossroads, the Crossroads Radio Show group, and on EBC Ministries page. It's in several different areas. And it basically, this article, I'm trying to look for the name here, where it is, but it's That Much Farther South, it's called, Who Still Promotes Clayton Jennings. And it's over at Pulpit and Pen, and you guys can check it out there. And basically, it kind of lists where he's going to be in the next couple days, and we're kind of asking you guys to get out there and maybe give those places a call. Give him a shout, and if you're concerning Bible-believing Christian, you don't think he should be there speaking after what he's done, check out the articles and check out the information for yourself. Just don't take it on what I'm saying. Check it out, and, you know, if you're a discerning Bible-believing Christian, you care about, you know, proper representation of biblical Christianity by those who are qualified to represent Christianity, and not just qualified theologically, but also qualified morally, ethically, and you know, give these places a call and express your concern about them having him come speak at their locations. I mean, this is something we have to, as Christians, we got to kind of be watchdogs and kind of look at and go, hey, this is happening. Maybe these people aren't aware of. Maybe they are, and they just don't care. Like Seth here noted that where he's going to be speaking here this Saturday on the 21st at 6 p.m. in Sebring, Florida, at a place called Dee's Place, or it's a restaurant, it's not a church. Now note, this is why I say I think he's stuck to smaller venues, because he's at a restaurant. He said that Pulpit and Penn contacted this venue in January about Jennings. The person answering the phone seemed unconcerned. So, I would suggest maybe you guys need to start calling, you know, listening to this, maybe start calling these places and list and giving, you know, your concern as Christians. Hey, well, why are you having this person here who has these accusations of immoral behavior speaking at your churches, at your locations? I mean, it's not that. And here's the thing. Let me clarify this too. With Jennings, it's not even. I mean, we're all sinners. We all have broken the law. We're all, you know, we're washed clean in the blood of Christ as Christians. But here's the thing. Here's the thing. You, as Christians, sins have consequences, regardless of if we are washed clean in the blood of Christ. Sins have consequences, earthly consequences, that we cannot escape. And this is one of them that, you know, and it's not to say, like I said, that Jennings couldn't go preach the gospel or do something, but he can't in the state he's in. And that's the thing. He is unrepentant of his past sins. He just wants to wash them aside from what we can tell. And, you know, I he might have repented before Christ. He might, but he is not publicly, you know, acknowledged, and he is a public figure. And this is the difference between somebody like Joe Blow down the street and someone in, you know, in public ministry. Joe Blow down the street commits a sin and, you know, repents before the Lord. Well, it's done and washed. You know, and done with. Maybe he's got to repent to his wife. Maybe he's got to repent to his kids or whatnot. You know, the case. But here's the thing. When we are in the lime of the public light and we speak to the public on behalf of a ministry or whatever, you're held to a different standard. You're held to a different scruple, if you want to say. And when you're held to that and you do things, well, you're not only just affecting you, you're not just only affecting the people around you, but you're also affecting a greater those who are, you know, I hate using this term because, you know, looking up to you or watching you or whatever, I just don't like using it, but I don't know any other way to put it, really. I don't, you know, and you're unwilling, you need not only to repent before the Lord, which rightly you have to do, first of all. I mean, you cannot not repent before the Lord. You have to. But you also then have to repent before those who you are affecting and who, you know, and make it publicly known. Hey, I did this. I need to repent of it. Blah, 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 blah. This was in my past. I haven't, you know, I've repented of it. I need to go forth. You know, maybe I need to step down for a while. That you know, you need to do those things in the public ministry. Unfortunately, Jennings is not willing, from what I've seen, is my opinion, is willing to do that. Instead, he wants to leave the church that was practicing, and this is a kudos to Harbor Shore Church and Tony Nolan. They wanted to practice biblical discipline, biblical church discipline. Told him, hey, you got to step down for a while. You got to do, you know, instead, nope. He wanted to be stiff-chested and bowel-breathing, and nope, I'm going to go off and do what I want to do because I'm Clayton Jennings and I can do that. He doesn't have a humble, repentive, teachable spirit. So right there, it's concerning. And as Christians, we look at this, and maybe you look at this article, like I said, over at Pulpit and Pen. You need, you know, check it out, pulpitandpen.org. Check it out, and you need to, you know, look at these things and go, hey, maybe I need to call these, maybe lay it upon your heart, call these places and say, hey, why do you have an unrepentative person coming and preaching the supposed gospel? And I've had my own run-ins with this type of, you're going to run into this hostile, people are going, oh, well, he repented before the Lord, that's good. I mean, I've had pastors say that. We had here in Wisconsin, where I'm located, at the time, back in October, I believe it was, when I contacted the church he was speaking at the time, the pastor seemed totally uncaring that, you know, Jennings, that these accusations around. He was like, well, whatever, you know, I'm just going to let him speak in front of all these people and say whatever, you know, and not, you know, question it, or maybe, you know, he's just like, whatever. So you have to at this point ask yourself, looking at this, what are these churches that are now promoting this basically and allowing these people to come speak, or Clayton Jennings to come speak at his church? Are they really biblical churches? I mean, are they really out to protect the flock? Are they really discerning churches? I guess that would be more my question. Are they really biblical churches? You know, okay, they're letting... it could be ignorance. But are they really dis... are they really discerning churches? Are they really willing to contend for the faith? And that's something I would ask, you know, be asking. Because, honestly, what this is coming down to now, I think the churches that are promoting him, that are promoting Jennings at this point, are business model churches. They're the Perry Noble type of business structure church. And they're in a business. They're not in into being a church for the sake of being a church, for being the bride of Christ. They're in it for being a business. They're in it for allowing, or for selling, for making money. I wouldn't doubt if some of these churches, if you look at it, they don't have a biblical setup of basically, you know, of hierarchy of a church. They instead must probably have like a CEO platform or business model type of church. And that's where we're at with this type of, with Jennings and his type, you know, in him going forth. But main point here I just want to bring up is that we have to, as Christians, be aware of and be very careful who we let come speak at our churches. And let this be kind of a warning. Let this whole Jennings thing, this Clayton Jennings thing, be a warning to those sitting in the pew. Just because your pastor brings somebody in, check that person out before you go attend it. I mean, and this is not to say your pastor is purposely deceiving somebody or deceiving the flock. I mean, sometimes, honestly, you know, your pastor is a busy person. If he's truly being a pastor, he's busy counseling people. He's busy, you know, preparing the sermon. He's doing pastoral activities. So he can't know everything that's going on in the discernment world that, hey, this person said this back in this person believes this, you know, back on, you know, at this website. So that, you know, that's kind of what the discernment guys out in the watchdog kind of guys, the sheepdogs, if you want to say, out in the congregation of believers in that church are for. Question is your pastor receptive to those type of people? Or is he just like, hey, this guy looks popular, I'm going to bring him in because that's going to boost my popularity? That's what you have to be careful of when you're, you know, even in your own church. I mean, it's very easy for anybody to want to jump on a popularity wagon. Hey, this guy sounds good, let's bring him in because, hey, he's going to get 1,500 people here. Normally I have only 500 people. You know, that's what you got to be careful of. And you got to be discerning. And then at that point, you go to your elders, you go to your church and say, hey, you know, this guy said, with the facts in a loving, caring way, not in a bulldog, you know, bull in a china shop kind of attitude, slamming your fists and, you know, saying, hey, I'm going to leave this church if you let this heretic speak. No, you approach it, you go lovingly because, you know, that's what is Christ, as Christians, is what we need to do. But you approach the board, you approach your, you know, your elder board, you approach your pastor with the information. Then you let God work on him. You pray, and you let God work on him. And if he goes forth and lets that false teacher, or, you know, that, you know, person of, I don't even want to say false teacher. Yes, in some cases, I guess it could be a false teacher, but let's put this way, this person of ill repute into the pulpit and speak, or up onto the stage and speak. And maybe you just don't attend. Maybe you silently protest and you don't attend. Don't make a big scene. Maybe your family doesn't attend. And when you're asked, why am I not attending this? You make it known. And you speak your piece in a loving way, because I have these concerns. And that's kind of what you need to do. And you don't, you know, necessarily get up and leave the church over one little thing like that. But you make your protest known, and you do so in a Christian manner, in a Christ-loving manner. That's going to lead people back to the truth and not away from it. That's how you want to approach it. Now, so you know, here's the thing. a lot of this deals with, and you know, I've seen a lot of this, and you know, we got like 3-4 minutes left in the show here, and I've seen a lot of different things. I've been all over the place. I've seen a lot of different churches, been to a lot of different churches, and I've dealt with a lot of different pastors, a lot of different, you know, things dealing with that, you know, pastoral staff and all that throughout my travels throughout the United States. And I'll say this much, you know, I've had pastors lunge over the desk at me because, you know, I don't believe in, you know, their certain theological view on the rapture. Okay? You know, yeah, reason to lunge over a desk at you. But, okay. You know, the guy was a little bit emotional about it, but whatever. I've had all sorts of kind of interesting things happen about that. Well, there's two types of people, and I've noted, you know, noticed this in the congregations. There's two types of people. Those two types of people are basically, you got your sheep and your sheepdogs. And I don't mean like sheep like in a bad way. I don't mean like, you know, sheeple that just, you know, follow around blind. You know, nothing bad like that. Nothing, you know. But you have your sheep and your sheepdogs. And your sheepdogs are the type of person, and maybe you're this type of person. I know I'm this way. You're always kind of looking and evaluating the situation and seeing what is going on. You know, where's the catch, where's the hang up? You know, you're always investigating. You're not just going along for the ride. And maybe you're the type of person in this manner, too. And it's kind of, you're the sheepdog if you're this way. And what I mean by the sheepdog, if you have ever done any, you know, seen sheep, and you've seen, like, you know, cows being wrestled or anything like that, you're the dog running around protecting. You know, you're the sheepdog. You know, you're the protector. Maybe you're this type of person, you sit. When you go into a restaurant, you sit with your back to the wall and you're checking out things, okay? You walk into a place and you're automatically, okay, there's an exit here, there's an exit there. If this happens, I'm going to do this, I can do that, I can do this. And you're always got your back to the wall because you're checking out the scene, situation. You're always paying attention to what's going on around you. You know, and that type of thing. I mean, it's just, I believe that's a gifting from God. That's a gifting from God. You know, it's extra discerning, I guess, if you want to say, you know. And you're always in that mode discerning. And, you know, it's a gift. And we need to have that gift. We need those people in the church. We need to listen to those people in the church. And pastors have to be willing to listen to those people in the church and listen and understand those type of people, and not just shut them down. Because, like I said, if your pastor is doing what he's supposed to be doing as a pastor, he's not going to have time to sit there and read the 55 million different articles out there on Clayton Jennings and his, you know, past and what he's done and what he's done to seduce women and lie about it and then, you know, force a couple of them or one of them, at least one of them, to take the morning after pill after their in a night of fornication and whatnot, and all those various things. You know, your pastor's not going to have time to do that type of stuff. But here's the thing. There's those out in your church congregation that are willing and have the gift to do that, and that's not everybody's forte, and that's not everybody's spiritual gift. And a lot of people don't have, if you want to say, the thick skin to do that. And your pastor might not have the thick skin to do that, because I'll be very honest with you. The difference, you know, a good discernment guy, a good sheepdog, a good polemicist, a good apologist, a lot of times does not make a good pastor. Because the two are kind of contradictorial to themselves. Is that even a word? I think I just made up a word. But, regardless, it's your polemicist, your apologist, is not generally as much as a good pastor, as much as a pastor is not a good polemicist and apologist, because the two are very different. To be an apologist, to be a polemicist, to be a sheepdog, a watchdog, whatever you want to call it, however you want to put it, you have to be thick-skinned. You got to be kind of rough. You got to be able to kind of, you know, roll around in the mud, if you want to say, and not get dirty. And know when to be compassionate, but also know when not to be compassionate, and just to say the way things are. And if you're a pastor, your heart's a little more compassionate, and you're always wanting to, you know, find the best in somebody, and, you know, maybe not be so bulldogish, if you want to put it that way. But, you know, like I said, as a pastor, you need to be willing to accept and go, hey, yeah, you know what, maybe this guy's right. Maybe, you know, maybe I need to look into this. Maybe I need to check all this kind of, you know, this stuff out. It's, you know, very much the case a lot of the times. So, well, anyways, we got to get out of here. It's about 5 o'clock, and it is time to go. Well, we'll be next week on from 4 to 5 p.m. on Facebook Live and also here on Spreaker. So thank you for listening to Crossroads Radio. Well, that's all we have for this episode of Crossroads Radio, where theology and life intersect. I hope you enjoyed today's episode. If you have questions or comments about past episodes or anything you heard on today's episode, maybe you have a question about the Bible, God, theology, Jesus, cults, and other religions, please contact us at askcrossroadsradio@gmail.com. Make sure to stay up to date on all that's happening in Christian apologetics, polemics, and worldview issues by joining our Facebook group at the Crossroads Radio Show. Remember, Crossroads Radio is an outreach of EBC Ministries, which can be found at empoweredbychrist.org. While you're at the website, make sure to check out our latest articles on polemics, apologetics, and worldview issues, false religions, cults, and much, much more. Again, thank you for listening to Crossroads Radio, where theology and life intersect. By the blood of a man, I'm so glad. Yes, I'm so glad. I'm so glad. Last time by his mercy I've been spared.